Okay, thank you. So, good morning everyone, and thank you for attending this presentation that will be about the research currently underway developed with Professor Gronchi and Giulio Bau. The research is about an alternative application of a very classical method, the Patch-de-Konigs approximation, which is typically used for the design of interplanetary trajectories. Our goal is to investigate whether it is possible to exploit a similar technique consisting in patching basic dynamics in order to model more complex problems, and specifically the problem we're interested in is the short period evolution of near-Earth satellites moving under the gravitational influence of the Earth and the solar radiation pressure, taking into account the effects of the Earth's shadow. In order to model this problem, that we have called the sun shadow problem, we have patched the two integrable dynamics, Kepler's dynamics and Stark's dynamics. During this presentation, I will describe this model and I will explain the idea behind it. Then I will discuss some meaningful characteristics of Stark's problem before talking about the sun shadow problem. And in particular, I will give proof of the existence of a family of periodic orbits of break type, which are orbits developing between two zero velocity points. And I will introduce the sun shadow map, which is a tool used to analyze the dynamical behavior of the system. So, let's start. The model that we have adopted has been inspired by a work of Beletsky. If we consider near-Earth satellites whose orbital altitude is sufficiently high and whose area to mass ratio is sufficiently large, the solar radiation pressure can become a significant perturbation. However, it does not act inside the Earth's shadow region. Thus, in this region, we can adopt a Keplerian model for the dynamics. Moreover, we are interested in the short period evolutions of these satellites' orbits. So, we can neglect the shift of the Sun on the celestial sphere, and meaning that we can approximate the solar radiation pressure force as a constant force. So, as a consequence, in the out-of-shadow region, we can adopt the Stark's dynamics, which consists in an accelerated Kepler's dynamics obtained by adding a constant force to the classical two-body problem. Up to now, we have considered the planar case in which the solar radiation pressure force lies on the plane of motion of the satellites. In this slide, we show Kepler's dynamics and Stark's dynamics and the corresponding Hamiltonian HK and HS. In this formula, the E1 direction is aligned with the x-axis in the Cartesian plane, and it is the direction of the solar radiation pressure acceleration whose magnitude is equal to F. Px and Py are the moments conjugated to the variables x and y. Both Kepler's dynamics and Stark's dynamics are integrable. Indeed, the two-dimensional Stark's problem is characterized by two first integrals, the energy, so the Hamiltonian HS, and the projection of the generalized Laplace length vector onto the E1 direction LS. The Kepler's problem is characterized by several first integrals. However, in this context, just two are required, and we have adopted as well the energy, so the Hamiltonian HK, and the projection of the Laplace length vector onto the E1 direction LK. There exists a set of variables which is more suitable to study both Stark's problem and the sun shadow problem. So we have introduced the U and V variables and the corresponding conjugated moment PU and PV by means of the change of variables here reported in the slide. We have also introduced another time variable, the fictitious time tau, because in this way the system is Hamiltonian also in the new variables. These variables are similar to those used for the Levi Civita regularization, so they allow to handle the possible collisions with the Earth during the numerical propagation of trajectories. Moreover, they have another advantage. Indeed, in the Hamilton-Jacobi equations expressed in the new coordinates, the u and the v variables are separated, and this variable separation leads to the two sets of equations here reported. So we can understand that it is possible to analyze the evolution of the v-u variable independently from the evolution of the v-variable. Notice that these equations depend on the values of the first integrals that I've previously introduced. So I would like to do a remark. While a point in the UV plane corresponds to just one point in the Cartesian plane, the inverse is not true. So a point in the Cartesian plane can correspond to two possible points in the UV plane, and a consequence of this is that the Earth shadow region is doubled in this plane. So, as anticipated, I would like to talk about some essential aspects of the Stark's problem, and in particular, one of its main characteristics is that all the possible trajectories can be divided into four different categories, depending on the values of the first integrals HS and LS. Let's consider these two equations coming from the variable separation. The squares of the conjugated moment PU and PV must be positive. And this condition imposes some restrictions on the interval of definitions of the U and V components of the trajectories. In this slide, we show these quantities, xi1, xi2, eta1, and eta2, which are the squares of the values of u and v, for which the corresponding conjugated moment are equal to zero. These quantities depend on hs and ls. So we can understand that as these quantities vary, the interval of definitions for u and v vary, and as a consequence, we can obtain different kinds of trajectories. We can analyze this problem on this plane in which the abscissas are given by the values of ls and the ordinates depend on the energy hs. We can identify four different regions. In the first three regions, we have unbounded trajectories with different characteristics. In region four, which is a very important region also for the sun shadow problem, we can have two kinds of trajectories, bounded trajectories and unbounded trajectories, which are self-intersecting and which do not encircle the center of attraction. In this figure, we show the admissible subset in the configuration space, considering both the UV plane and the Cartesian plane, of course, at the variation of the considered region. And in case of region 1 and region 4 in the configuration space, it is possible to find the points in which the velocity is equal to zero. Region 4 is very significant also because it is the only region for which the U and V components of the trajectories can be periodic and bounded. So in this region we can find the periodic orbits, and we have shown some example here in this slide. However, there exists a family of periodic orbits which is not related to region 4. It exists for values of Ls between minus mu and mu, and for an energy equal to H star, whose expression is reported in this slide. So this family corresponds to the boundary between region 4 and region 2. These orbits are of break type, so they develop between two zero velocity points. Moreover, this family is very significant because if we consider the phase portrait in the PU-U plane traced for a fixed value of LS, the periodic orbit of break type is responsible for the two hyperbolic points that appear here and here. This family is also very important for the sun shadow problem. Indeed, also for the sunshadow dynamics, there exists a family of periodic orbits of break type, which is very close to this family introduced now. So, let's come back to our problem. As anticipated, as already explained, the sunshadow dynamics erases by patching Kepler's dynamics and Stark's dynamics. And as a consequence, the flow develops by alternating Kepler's regime in the shadow region with the Stark's regime. In this slide, you can observe the development of a trajectory, the same trajectory, on both the Cartesian plane and the UV plane. Each time the satellite crosses a boundary of the shadow region, the energy and the projection of the generalized Laplace lens vector onto the E1 direction change. So even though these quantities are constant while a satellite is in a specific regime, they will change in time. And as a consequence, the functions that we have previously introduced, HS, HK, LS, and LK, are not the first integrals for the sunshadow problem. As already said, the sunshadow problem is characterized by a family of periodic orbits of break type, which is close to that of the pure Stark's problem. And even in this case, this family exists for values of LS, which belongs to a specific interval, which is slightly smaller than the corresponding interval for Stark's problem. From now on, I will talk about sun shadow periodic orbits and Stark's periodic orbit in order to distinguish them. And in order to demonstrate the existence of the sunshadow periodic orbits of break type, we've exploited all the pieces of information we had about the Stark's periodic orbit of break type. So we have fixed the value of LS, and we have searched for an initial point belonging to the x-axis in the Cartesian plane with an x-coordinate equal to x0, which will be our independent variable. So an initial point in Stark's regime, allowing to reach a zero velocity point in Stark's regime. So we have searched for an orbit symmetric with respect to the x-axis. Moreover, we have imposed a condition on x0 by considering the physics of the problem. Indeed, if we take into account that crossing the shadow region, the pushing effect of the solar radiation pressure is lacking, we have searched for an initial point on the right of the initial point that the Stark's periodic orbit would have if the shadow was missing. This point that we will call Stark's initial point is characterized by an x-coordinate equal to xi star over 2, where xi star is equal to minus f times h star. I remind you that h star is the value of the energy of the Stark's periodic orbit, and it is also the value of the energy at the boundary between region 4 and region 2. And by considering this, we need to impose another condition on the initial point, so on x0. Indeed, we need to search for an initial point such that the energy in Stark's regime, HS, is lower than H star. In this way, we obtain a configuration corresponding to points belonging to region 4. So in the configuration space, it is possible to find zero velocity points, and orbits of break type are possible, which is not the case in case of region 2. Of course, we have exploited the U and V coordinates in order to analyze this problem. And in the UV plane, the initial points corresponds to two possible points belonging to the U-axis, one with a new coordinate equal to the root square of 2 times x0, and the other one with a new coordinate which is equal but with an opposite sign. The other two points shown in the image corresponds to the Stark's initial point. For symmetry reason, we can focus only on the positive values of the U component. So, by imposing the previous conditions, we have found out that there exist values of x0, for which in Stark's regime we have that HS, the energy, is lower than H star. So we have a configuration corresponding to points belonging to region 4. In order to find the exit point from the shadow, we have solved this system of four equations coming from Kepler's dynamics. And we have that the exit point is characterized by a new coordinate and a v-coordinate, which depend on this quantity xi, which is just the squares of the u-coordinate, where xi, of course, is given as a function of x0. And xi must be real and positive. And this is always verified if Ls belongs to the interval which is reported here in the slide, that, as anticipated, is slightly smaller than the corresponding one for the Stark's problem. So once we found the expression of the exit point from the shadow, we could determine the expression of the energy in Stark's regime, Hs, as a function of x0. Hs is a strictly decreasing function of the independent variable x0. Moreover, if the initial point tends to the Stark's initial point, Hs tends to a value which is higher than H star, so it corresponds to a configuration associated to region 2. However, there exists a value of x0 star, for which the initial point is on the right of the Stark's initial point, and for which Hs is equal to H star. So by considering these pieces of information, we have that there exist values of x0 larger than x0 star, for which Hs is lower than H star. And in these cases, we have unbounded trajectories. So at this point, we have several pieces of information. We know the expression of the exit point, of course, as a function of x0. We know the expression of the energy in Stark's regime. We know also the kind of trajectories we have in Stark's regime. And so we can obtain the expression of the zero velocity point, which will have a new coordinate equal to the root square of xi1 and a v coordinate equal to the root square of eta1, where xi1 and eta1 are given as function of Hs, as previously shown, and as a consequence, they are functions of x0. So at this point, we just miss one relation in order to conclude the proof, and it concerns the fictitious time. Thanks to the variable separation, the fictitious time can be given as a function of either the u variable or the v variable. So the fictitious time from the exit point to the zero velocity point must be equal to both theta u, the fictitious time expressed as a function of u, and as a function of, and it must be equal also to tau v, which is the fictitious time given as a function of v. So we need to impose tau u equal to tau v. Otherwise, we obtain trajectories which exist but which do not correspond to the orbit we are searching for. So tau u is a strictly decreasing function of x0. Moreover, for x0 tending to x0 star, tau u is characterized by a positive infinite limit, while tau v is a not monotone function of x0, and for x0 tending to x0 star, tau u is characterized by a finite limit. We have estimated tau u and tau v, and we have found out that there exists a value of x0, x0 bar, for which the lower bound estimate of tau v is equal to the upper bound estimate of tau u. So if x0 is equal to x0 bar, tau v is higher than tau u. However, if x0 tends to x0 star, tau u is higher than tau v. So there must be exist at least one point in which tau u is equal to tau v, and as a consequence, the periodic orbit we are searching for exists. In this slide, we show the periodic orbit, and we show two closed trajectories for which tau u is different from tau v. So now, before concluding, I would like to introduce the sun shadow map, which is used to analyze the dynamical behavior of the sun shadow system. It is a Poincaré map obtained by intersecting the trajectories with the phase space section here reported that in the configuration space, in particular in the Cartesian plane, corresponds to the upper boundary of the shadow region, considering a motion direction outward the shadow. In order to define this map, we have not fixed the energy as in more traditional problems, since it is not a constant, but we have fixed the value of Ls. Indeed, even though this quantity is not a constant for the flow, it is a constant for the map, as we can understand by considering this sketch.
Let's assume.
Yes?
10 minutes.
Okay,
still
thank
have
you.
10 minutes, 5 for concluding and 5 for questions.
Thank you. Let's suppose we have satellites exiting from the shadow region at the Poincaré section at the point P0. Of course, Ls will have a certain value, Ls0. So, at a certain point, the satellite will cross again the boundary of the shadow region by entering Kepler's regime. And at the crossing point P1, the projection of the generalized Laplace length vector onto the E1 direction will change by a quantity which depends on F and the Earth radius R. Then the satellite will return at the Poincaré section at the point P2, and again the projection of the generalized Laplace length vector will change by the same quantity but with an opposite sign. So at the end, the value of Ls at the point P2 will be equal to the value of Ls at point P0. So Ls is actually a constant for sun shadow map. Notice by comparing these two images that the upper boundary of the shadow region in the Cartesian plane is doubled in the UV plane. Okay, the map is differentiable, even though the sun shadow flow is not differentiable. Moreover, if we look at the map, we can notice that there are fixed points and highlands, which are probably clues of a chaotic behavior. These highlands and fixed points have been very useful for us because they allowed us to identify other periodic orbits different from those whose existence has been previously demonstrated. And here in the slide, we show two examples. About the periodic orbit of break type, it is responsible of the two hyperbolic points that appear here and here. So, to conclude, right now we are trying to visualize the hyperbolic points of the separatrices on the sun shadow map by exploiting the Fast-Lyapunov indicators. Moreover, we would like to search for the possible homoclinic points of the separatrices, for example, by exploiting the Melnikov method. And in future, we would like also to analyze the same problem in a three-dimensional configuration space. Here there is a brief bibliography used for our work, and that's it. Thank you for the attention, and if you have any question, I will be happy to answer.